From Providence, Rhode Island, welcome to Outlander Cast. It's a podcast dedicated to the show Outlander on Stars.
Me a song of a loss that is gone. Say, could that loss be I? Mary of souls, she sailed on a day.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back. My name is Mary Larson.
My name is Blake, and yeah.
That was an episode.
We got a murder mystery afoot.
Dun, dun, dun.
Holy smokes.
There's a Colonel Mustard in the library with a candlestick holder.
I think it was a guy with a ponytail.
Which one? Everybody.
A red one.
A red ponytail.
I think it's the red ponytail. Well.
We're going to find out.
I'm still in development on that one.
Okay, but we're going to delve into this a little bit.
As I promised on Facebook, I have a Chernobyl sized take for this episode.
A Chernobyl sized outlandish theory?
Oh yeah, a Chernobyl sized outlandish
wow.
theory. So I'm getting my podcast mixed up here.
Okay, yeah.
Because this is like radiation just spewing out of me.
Oh, I love
That's how hot this
You know, it's so
is.
Hard because as a book reader, knowing whodunit and what happens next and all this kind of stuff, I'm going to be doing a lot of interestings. As our fellow book readers, they're just going to sit there and go, interesting.
Yeah. Hold on, I'm sorry. I'm going to take a picture of us right now.
So for those of you, tuning in the future, I continue to be ill. And we are podcasting again from bed because it's the end of the day. Our kids did not want to fall asleep. We're recording at 9:31 at night. And, it would be hard for me to record at 9:31 at night healthy.
Never mind sick.
But we've got some good news. I am going to be accepted into our state's long COVID clinic. And I will probably start in May, and I'm really excited.
So excited.
I feel like I was accepted into college, except I'm accepted because I'm so sick.
And here's something fun, ladies and gents. The picture I just took, I'm going to be putting up on the socials. You'll be able to see it at the Mary and Blake Facebook page and on Instagram.
Oh.
Wanted to let you know that I brought out our old podcasting unit that we had when we first started podcasting.
When we first started Outlander
Cast. Our first microphones, our first little audio box.
So if you've been with us since the beginning, and we podcasted on our dining room table with these microphones propped up on books.
We call it our diva boxes.
Yes, we did.
We're back to using them because, listen, I quite like doing the shows from bed because I think it's cute. And I get to make all the in-bed jokes, and who doesn't love the in-bed jokes? But the sound quality that we were getting was just not to my standard. So I had a brilliant idea, and now I have a little mobile podcasting unit in our bedroom so that when we are ready to podcast and Mary can and she's feeling okay, we can do it from bed and still get 80%.
Except I have to hold this microphone. That
yeah, we don't have the
energy.
Diva boxes anymore.
I need a bed diva box.
No, you have to sit up more and kind of like rest like how I am.
No, I don't want to sit up more. That takes more energy.
So just please appreciate the effort that we're putting in here, ladies and gents, because we're doing some good work here. I'm so proud. And Mary is already yawning. You can probably hear it. So we're going to get this podcast train
moving. Listen, I need to talk about this episode.
Yeah, you do.
If you're in the future and you haven't recently watched this episode, we have a recap for you.
All right. You ready to get into the show?
Yes, I am.
All right, let's do it. So, as this was written by our intrepid writer, Angela Hickey, thank you so much, Angela. I'm going to read it. Here's a mini recap. Let's go. So, we enter our two-week break with a shocking ending for the episode to mull over. But before we get started, here's our recap. 606, the world turned upside down. By the way, That
the
little,
world turned upside down.
That little red herring of the world turned upside down. Not happy with that. Not happy.
What do you mean?
You know what? Don't go breaking on Hamilton.
Why not?
If it's not going to be Hamilton,
Alexander Hamilton
adjacent.
What?
I just felt like that was just...
Yeah. I love it. I love it. It's like, you love Revolutionary War stuff?
Yep.
Me too.
It opens with an upside-down shot from the inside of the church, which rights itself as Roger preaches a sermon, which the weak things of the world confounding to the strong and the low things turning what exists to nothing. As the episode unfolds, Roger's message becomes a bit of a prophetic as a microscopic amoeba in the water kills a dozen or more Ridge residents with dysentery. The Dr. Claire medicine woman nearly dies herself of a different mysterious bacterial infection, a twin to the illness that hits Tom Christie. Dun dun dun. Interesting.
Colonel Mustard.
Claire
back
was,
at it again.
Claire, while in a severe fever, sees visions of snakes and amoebas and a beating heart swirling in her mind, along with the blurred vision of Malva creepily consoling Jamie by the window. She wakes a week later with Roger at her side and her infamous hair cut off thanks to Malva and Mrs. Bug. Again, the theme of the small bringing down the mighty rings when the Christies come galloping up to the big house. Wee weird Malva is pregnant and tries to trap and extort the king of men by naming him as her baby daddy. Claire slaps Malva and runs out, but Malva can prove her story. She knows more about the more private scars on his body
sort of
that peeping Tom move really paid off. The Frasers are now shunned but solidly still supporting each other. Roger and Jamie attend the provincial convention in New Bern, where the lowly colonies are planning rebellion against the greatest military force of its time, and again, the low will overcome the mighty. And while they are gone, Claire attempts to show grace and mercy to Malva, and Malva does start to take Claire's olive branch, but Alan shuts it down, accusing Claire of witchcraft, and Malva concurs. Strong woman Claire now finds herself prisoner to the past trauma with and ether addiction, and in a final jaw-dropping stroke, Claire finds Malva in her garden with a slit throat which happened while Claire was passed out on her ether trip. Claire desperately does a C-section on the spot to save the baby, but the baby is D.E.D. dead. We end with a devastated Claire kneeling in the middle of a gruesome scene in her garden, looking very guilty to whoever stumbles along next. A dead baby in her hands, a carved up Malva on the ground before her, and her own bloody knife flung by her side. Not great Bob.
And not very friendly. I gotta tell you. I knew it was coming, but I could not watch that C-section.
Yeah. That's...
It's gross sound effects.
Dude, that was something.
And Katrina Balfe was pregnant when she had to film that scene.
Gracious.
Imagine doing that in general. Imagine doing that as a woman. And then imagine doing it while you have your own child growing within you. Ah!
Well, this episode was entitled The World Turned Upside Down. And Angela, I think, has already touched upon one of the many reasons why it was entitled The World Turned Upside Down. It was written by none other than Toni Graphia.
Love Toni.
Love Toni Graphia. Toni is just...
They said, Toni, we have a lot of ground to cover.
We need, an expert to get in here and fix this.
We
so,
basically need three episodes
in one. So why don't you make that happen? So I will say this. Toni had, I think, an impossible job.
I concur.
But we'll get there in a minute. She was the co-showrunner, I think, really, of season 3 and 4, along with Matt Roberts, though it seems like Matt Roberts has now taken the full reins, which makes sense because at the time, Matt was no more than a co-producer. And she, Toni, had been working with Ron Moore ever since her BSG days, right? Back in Battlestar Galactica. So it made sense for her to kind of be the wise sage to help Matt along during this process. She has written many of the Outlander episodes dating back all the way to season 1. In fact, she's one of the, I think, the only two writers left from that season 1 crew. She and Matt Roberts. She's written episodes Rent, The Devil's Mark, The Watch, La Dame Blanche, Faith, Dragonfly and Amber, Of Lost Things, Freedom and Whiskey, Eye of the Storm, America the Beautiful, The Birds and the Bees, Man of Worth, Between Two Fires, The Ballad of Roger Mack, Never My Love, and obviously this episode. That list of episodes...
Woo! Those are doozies.
Those are heavy, frackin' hitters. heavy hitters. I mean, of Lost Things, Dragonfly and Amber, quite possibly the best episode of Outlander yet.
In your opinion, yeah.
She does, you know, she's got the watch, whatever, but La Dame Blanche, The Devil's Mark, she got Rent, which I was out on Rent.
You know, I enjoyed Rent as a replay.
America the Beautiful.
A lot.
I mean, Man of Worth.
Yeah.
The Ballad of Roger Mac. I mean, these are legit episodes. And for anybody to say that they don't like Toni Graphia's writing, they're on Planet Zippy.
Agreed.
They're on Planet Zippy. This one was also directed by Justin Molotnikoff, who directed the episode Temperance. And obviously, this episode. Mary, what do you got for your kilt rating?
My kilt rating is, I'd say a 4.8.
Okay. All right. Fair enough.
I liked it a lot. It's just, it was a lot.
It was a lot. And for me, because it was so much, it felt like, like you said, Mary, it felt almost like three episodes in one. And when you do that, it's too much. So I'm going to give this one a 4.41. Like pretty much on the same level as last week's episode.
Okay.
For me. You're good, bad, you're GBG. You're good, you're bad, and you're great.
All right. So my good is shit's hitting the fan. Freaking love it. Okay? Just give it to me.
Shit's hitting the fan.
Shit's hitting the fan. We got dead people in a garden, dead baby. We've got pregnancy rumors going up the wazoo. All the fisher folk being mean to Claire.
Oh, yeah.
And Claire's just like, oh, Jamie will be back in 2 months.
How about Mrs. Bug?
Bug just being a gossiper.
Like, she is Lady Whistledown.
Yeah. Oh, like, Julie Andrews, move over.
Oh, yeah. No.
Move
it's Mrs.
over.
Bug time.
She just hears that and goes and tells everybody. And you don't see her get reprimanded. You
no.
don't see Bree being like, shut your mouth. That's my dad.
By the way, if you are a fan of Lady Whistledown and Bridgerton, it's coming.
It's coming.
It's coming. You can go to maryandblake.com. Check out.
Start it next week.
We might be able to.
We might be able to because there's a week off out there.
That's right. So, although I was thinking about doing The Last Kingdom next week.
Okay, well, listen. My good is shit's hit.
What I'm saying is go to maryandblake.com. Check out Bridgerton with Mary and Blake.
They know,
if you
Blake.
Love Bridgerton.
They
well,
know.
You know what? Someone's got to sell the brand. It might as well be me.
Okay. So that's my good. I'm just here for all the stuff. I'm here for Claire being like, why am I even here?
Mm.
Why am I even here, Jamie? you like that. My bad.
Claire, why am I even here, Jamie?
I know that this is a time traveling show.
I love you more than I should have.
Why? And Jamie.
we should not be here. That's the first Claire voice
that
of the
is.
Season.
You're welcome.
Oh, I'm in.
My bad. I don't know when I am. Okay? I'm just very confused with time. And thank God they cut Claire's hair off so I can understand how much time has passed.
Lots
between
of time passing.
Claire's hair being cut off and seeing it grow and then Malva suddenly popping. Okay?
Yeah, like,
whoa. Hey, there's a baby in
that's
there.
That's a lot. And that's like that's a lot.
That's okay.
How long was she pregnant for? And how long was Jamie gone?
Jamie was gone for 2 months.
That baby does not grow that big in 2 months.
That baby had been growing for a while, Blake. It's because it's not Jamie's baby.
No, I know what I'm
that
saying.
That baby had been there for a while.
Yeah.
And it was her first pregnancy, most likely.
Yeah,
so
point.
She was holding it in for a little bit.
Yeah, you're right.
And you pop closer to the 6 month mark, whereas Bree's going to be popping quicker. Okay? It's her second baby.
Right. I mean, so I guess wouldn't people like you, especially Claire, wouldn't they be like, that baby is like super old. How could it be Jamie?
You know, the fisher folk, they don't care.
Yeah, they don't care about science.
No.
In reality, I suppose. Okay, fair
enough. So, that's my bad. Is aside from Tom Christie's writing a letter and it's like 1775 and Jamie's going off to the first Continental Congress meeting.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we're getting some time frames put in, but I'm still very confused.
Yep, gotcha.
Very confused on time.
Gotcha.
And then my great
mm-hmm.
was the moment with Jamie and Claire in the stables having that big conversation. I wanted more from Jamie during Claire's illness.
connection wise, mm-hmm. but I appreciate that they were like short on time and you got to see everybody there. And I just loved being able for him to finally be like, so I did sleep with someone. Granted, you actually were not alive
Who
then.
Who the hell is Mary McNabb? That is excellent writing.
From way back when, Blake.
No, I know. But when Claire was like, "Who's Mary McNabb?"
Oh yeah, Claire's like, "What the hell,
like,
Jamie?"
For Claire to just say that and the show to kind of wink at you while she says that,
yeah,
it means the show's in on the joke, and
yes.
I like that.
Yes, but also Claire's like, "I wasn't alive at all at that point,
yeah,
man."
So like, whatever.
You why are you faking me out, freaking me out right now?
She was alive, but she just was back to the future.
Yeah, but so she wasn't. She wasn't in that time frame alive.
And then, but like, the other thing, the other question I have about this
yeah.
is, why are we whistling past the graveyard here of William?
What about William?
And the chick he slept with?
Because she already knew about all those. He already told her about those.
All right, fair.
And William came about because he was being blackmailed.
That's
so that,
true.
So he
different.
Like... Yeah, he had sex. He laid with Mary McNabb. He like
William.
Chose
gotcha.
To do this.
And technically, he kind of did that with what's her name too. But
Claire
but no.
knew.
Yes.
She didn't know about Mary McNabb. So this is something he wanted to tell her: is that I like chose to lay with this woman.
Yeah.
To feel good, and I did not tell you about this one person.
Gotcha.
So that's why he wanted to get it off his chest
okay.
after all this time. So I just enjoyed that conversation because I loved Claire just kind of losing it for a little bit, even though she knew Jamie didn't sleep with the baby. And for her to say, oh, he's like, how did you know it wasn't my baby? And she said, because I know that you would never like give up a baby of your blood.
Yes, right.
Oh.
Oh,
no.
Boy.
No, he wouldn't, Claire.
No.
We know our Jamie.
King of men.
Truly. So that was my great. How about right. you? What's your GPG?
My good. The scene with Tom Christie when he just rolls up to the big house and is like, we got to talk.
Oh, those horses whinnying.
Oh, man. And then it just the tension of that moment.
Did they leave like that same day? Because he and Roger were packing up the trunk.
Yeah.
They had their nice clothes on. Did he just be like, okay, Claire, so Mrs. Bug is going to go gossip, but I got to go.
So I got things to do.
And my flight's in 10 minutes still. So I'll catch you in 2 months.
You know, TSA, really. It's the problem with TSA.
Like, how long did he stay?
You got to get to the stables at least an hour in advance.
Well, they have their little stable chat. He tells her about Mary McNabb, and then he's like, so, look at the time.
Hey.
Roger's there honking the horn.
I tell you, the TSA at the stables, you know,
no pre-check then.
They don't have enough. They don't got enough employees.
They don't have global entry.
The lines are taking forever.
Oh, especially after COVID.
I know. And you know,
AKA dysentery.
Yeah. You're not allowed to bring drinks because dysentery's everywhere.
Dysentery was the COVID of 1775.
Oh, man. But that scene.
Watch out for those amoebas.
That scene was terrific.
Which one?
The one with Tom Christie and where it's
in the house?
Like, in the house. It
okay.
was just a terrific scene. The tension was perfect. And that tension was even kind of released too when Tom Christie and Jamie are just manhandling Alan,
oh.
and they just keep smacking him like, "Shut up, dude! Go away!" You can't help but just laugh at how stupid
yes.
Alan is.
Yes.
So, but the way that it's written, and you could tell that Tom is pissed.
That his daughter's pregnant.
But he has a certain level of respect for Jamie. And he's like, okay, so you're...
Except he's like, she says she laid with the man a dozen times.
Right, and...
what? Melva, why do you have to add that insight?
So, I find it... it was excellent because Tom knows where he's at. And he knows that he's dealing with a man that is respected. And it's just like, okay, so you're going to sign this contract, right? Take my kid on this, my grandchild as an heir, right? Yes? Yeah. Okay, good. Good talk. I just loved that scene. It was very well constructed mm-hmm. And very well written. The bad for me was the dream sequences that Claire had. I thought they tried too hard.
The snake blood.
The snake and the blood and the hot and the whole thing. It's just like, I know you're trying to be psychedelic here.
She's trying to be like Master Raymond time again.
I know, and I know you. I know what you're trying to do, but it just wasn't working.
I mean, because here's the thing. We all have weird dreams, right? We
Absolutely.
All have weird dreams where
Absolutely.
We wake up and we're like, whoa, snakes and blood and red and weird stuff. But it is hard to bring that across on screen.
Yeah, and especially the way that they did it, too. It's like these close-up shots of a snake. Like, if it was a dream that, like, Claire could see herself in like, the third person, and she's, like, a snake is going by her.
Well, we also don't see Claire dream while she's taking ether. We have it as, like, you fall
it's
asleep,
a fever dream.
And you... No, Claire saw the snake and the blood and the heart and all that kind of stuff when she did the ether, right?
Oh, yeah, maybe you're right.
Or did she do it?
Oh, no, no.
Oh, no, it was fever time.
It was fever time.
Okay, all right, now I feel better. Never mind.
What I'm saying is...
Okay, so she can... I'm okay with that.
I was not.
Why are you not okay with it?
I thought they tried too hard. And, like, they tried too hard to be a little edgy with the heart and the hand and everything. It just...
It was a messed up dream,
Mike. What I wanted from the dream sequence was like a more realistic dream where you think, oh, wow, snake's in the house. Like, weird. Like, and why is Claire holding this heart? But it's not. Then you realize, oh, this is a dream.
But dreams don't make sense. Dreams are
exactly
a lot of quick cuts. No, but like, it's not always. Mine are.
Dreams happen. Like, it. One of the best things that ever happened. In movie history is when Leonardo DiCaprio is talking to what's her name from the Umbrella Academy.
Yeah, you're really helpful right now. Okay. in the movie
Page,
Inception.
She's now Elliot Page, but at the time she was Ellen Page. He's talking in the movie Inception. He's talking, Leonardo DiCaprio is talking to Ellen Page. And he's saying, do you ever know when your dreams start? Like, how do you know you're not dreaming right now? And she's like, well, yeah, we talked, and then she realized, oh my God, I'm in a dream right now. And I just, that's what I wanted from that sequence.
But that's not how everyone dreams.
No, everyone absolutely dreams that way.
No.
You don't just all of a sudden say, oh, I'm dreaming now.
No, you don't know you're in a dream, but I'm saying that your dreams aren't always realistic. Sometimes dreams are abstract.
I know. I'm saying my preference was I didn't want to
But you are saying everyone
dream.
Has to dream the way that you dream.
No, I'm saying that everybody starts the dream the same way.
No, they don't.
Yes, they do. No one knows, okay, I'm dreaming now.
Why not?
Because you just don't know. All of a sudden, you just find yourself in a situation.
She didn't know she was dreaming right then.
You're not getting what I'm saying. It's okay. It's fine. Don't worry. Don't worry. It's okay.
I'm just saying, not everybody dreams like
but
you.
But my great, I have a tie. I have a tie. The scene when Jamie and Claire are in bed and she's talking about how she stepped on him. He almost broke her ribs and broke his ribs.
Oh, my God. That was amazing.
And they were laughing at each other.
The tenderness.
And then he's like, oh, what happened to your ass? Like, she's like, oh, don't worry. That's going to grow back.
Yeah.
I know that wasn't the same scene, but these little things are why the relationship between Jamie and Claire is tactile.
Oh my God. Even how they're going over her qualities and she's like, I'm patient. He's like, you are not patient.
Yeah.
And I'm gentle. No, you're not.
No, you're not at all.
And she's like, fine. So what do you like about me? And he says that you think I'm funny.
Yeah. That right there, again, perfect writing.
Okay, Claire, what is it? I'm gentle. Nah.
No.
I'm patient. No.
No. And you think I'm funny. Like, and they laugh about
it. Oh, it's so cute.
That is a legitimate married couple conversation.
Agreed.
And then the show, once again, acknowledging its own mythos, right? Just like that moment when she stepped on him as she opened the door and he was sleeping outside the door and back in season one. Like, that's really important stuff.
And what I love about that is you go through this and you're laughing and you have all the humor. And yet the kind of end point is the faithfulness.
Yes, absolutely.
And that, of course, comes into play later in the episode.
So I love that point. I love what they do with that. And it's also really good for the show to acknowledge itself in those early seasons Because since season three, since they have moved to America, this show has felt like two different shows. And I like that it can acknowledge itself for what it once was.
And we've kind of had a few callbacks, you know, just even referencing...
Frank in this episode.
Oh, yeah. But even Jamie talking to Ian about what it's like to have your culture stripped from you and you have to be moved from your lands. Things like that where they're kind of calling back.
We even had the flashbacks to Ardsmere. We had the flashback to the Bonnie Prince. But like those are big things that are kind of required of the show. This conversation between Jamie and Claire, it's just a character moment. It's just a moment between two people who love each other, who are remembering back to like, oh, remember that when that happened like 30 years ago?
Well, then Jamie even talks about his time in the cave.
Yes, exactly.
And, you know, we're able to kind of reference back to that. So I agree with you. These little references to remind you of how much time we have now spent with the Frasers.
Right, right. And then the other great that I have is it's the opening shot. It's the when everything is literally upside down and then everything turns and rights itself and then you see everybody in the church and everything. It is flashy. It is splashy.
Oh my God, I did not think they were flashy or splashy. I'm sitting there saying I would have fallen asleep in Roger's sermons.
Oh, no, what I'm saying, the shot itself
is flashy. This is not rock Jesus.
The shot itself is flashy. It's a look at me
yes.
moment.
Yes.
And I am here for it. As all of you know, this is a Mary and Blake Media commitment. Give me all the flashy. I want all the flashy you can give me.
Unless it's a dream.
Unless it's a dream when it sucks. Because
it's so funny.
I'm just saying the shots like that make a difference. It's not just camera A, camera B, over the shoulder, look at me, like this, that, and the other thing. That is what sets good TV apart from mediocre TV.
Okay.
Give me something flashy and something inventive. Tell me a story without telling me a story. It's like those TikToks, you know, tell me you're rich without telling me you're rich, or tell me you're from Massachusetts without telling me you're from Massachusetts.
Okay.
Tell me that you're a good show without telling me.
I can't believe you're just
tell me
TikToks.
The story that you're trying to convey without telling me.
Mm-hmm.
And that is what happened with that shot.
Love it.
Give me all the flashy.
Okay.
That might be my next t-shirt.
Okay.
You know, and that could probably be interpreted in a couple of different ways. Just throwing that out there, but I'm just going to say that. Give me all the flashy.
We've heard you say that now 5 times.
I'm going to keep saying it, too.
Oh, that's great.
All right, so Mava, well, stands out for you in this episode? Because we are already 27 minutes in to this.
We just finished the GBG. Can we go kind of a bit by bit through the episode?
Sure. Well, yeah, what do you got?
Okay, well, we open up in church. I'm bored.
Yeah.
Roger, great beard. Love that Jamie and Claire get to have a little PDA in church.
Yes.
Fun fact, I tried to convince Blake to go to church, to the Rock Jesus Church, which I joke, I've been a church nomad, and so I've gone to many different types, and if you've never been to a Rock Jesus Church, I'm telling you, they're an experience. That's when you get like the rock band up there, and they're singing all these like pop worship songs.
The guy took himself way too seriously.
What I loved about this place is they had like boutique donuts and they had like cold brew coffee like carts up at the place. So good. And the kids care was great. And I noticed, and I told Blake, I said, all the parents, this is like a date. They sit in church and they have their arms around each other. They're like stroking each other's hands because it's like they're 2 hours without their kids for the whole week. Plus they got their coffee and their bougie donut. This is a brunch date for these people and they get to go to a concert. So I almost sold Blake on the idea of going to church just so he could hold my hand for 2 hours without
That's
kids
true.
Bothering us. And we tried to go and we went 3 times. And each time we got called from kids care because our kids like pooped their diaper, like 2 diapers worth of stuff. You know, one was crying, all this stuff. And finally, the last time, as I was leaving church and the person was like, I'm sorry that the kids, you know, are crying or whatever. And I said, it's okay. Jesus gave me these kids. He just doesn't want me at this church. And I'm like, hey, these kids keep crying. So we'll come back one day. But I loved watching Jamie and Claire just sit there, have that little PDA moment. And you know who was peeping on that?
Who was that?
Tom Christie.
Tom Christie.
He was wishing that he could have a little PDA at Rock Jesus Church.
So are you getting
with
the
some
sense,
bougie donuts?
Are you getting the sense that the show is trying to convey to you that Tom is falling in love with Claire? Because if they are trying to convey that, they're doing a poor job.
I think just loneliness from what the show is showing me. Loneliness or isn't that nice? I don't have that. Nobody's holding my hand. I don't know. I think that there is, that you do get the sense that Tom Christie sees the tenderness in Claire. Mm-hmm. You know, she goes and checks up on him later. And, you know, he says to her, like, oh my gosh, I can't believe you came here. Is he smiling? Is he, you know, happy and lovely? No, but I don't think he ever could be. So I just, you notice that he sees that. You notice that he's seeing her behavior and they're touching in church.
Yes.
And then, of course, they leave church and Roger says, hey, that family with five kids, they stopped coming.
Yeah, the Larsons.
They're always here. They always come for the free donuts. They're the husband and wife who are like, 2 hours by myself? Deal.
Just to hold hands? Oh my God, yes.
He's like, I noticed they're not in the back nooking.
I'm legitimately Schmogging. Telling you, I'm legitimately telling you, listener, the only reason why I even conceded to going to Rock Jesus was just because I could hold Mary's hand for 2 hours. And just...
I have nicknames for all my churches. There's the smelly one with way too much incense.
This is the one that you don't talk?
That's my favorite one. The Quaker one?
Yeah, I know. I'm
the Friends kidding. House? That's not talk. A church. No, that's the Quaker house. That's the Friends house, the meeting house.
Sure, whatever.
I love that one.
That's for nerds.
You just look out the window and look at the leaves. It's awesome.
Just sit there and be quiet. Oh my God, it sounds like heaven. I mean, you know what? I think we should go to that one next. Just do nothing.
The Quaker one?
Yeah, sure.
Our kids probably won't be quiet enough.
I know.
We'll get kicked out of being Quakers.
No chance.
They actually are meeting virtually now. And they just sit in Zoom in silence. My mom started to go, and she said that she was going to a Christmas Eve service, and I said, what are you doing? She said, we all just light a candle on Zoom, and we sit in silence with a candle in Zoom.
By the way, let me say this. If Love that's it. What you do, I'm not laughing at you. I'm laughing because it's something that I want to do and just experience.
You made fun of me for going to the friend's meeting house.
Oh, I'm absolutely going to make fun of you, but I'm saying if that's what you do, like if you are a Quaker, I'm not making fun of you.
You can't say, I want to do that. And make fun of people at the same. My
I'm
mom,
not making fun of anybody. I think it's just funny
fun of me
that
for going
sit on Zoom and just don't do nothing.
That's my mom. It's not just people. My mom was on Zoom with her candle.
Oh man. It's
been a weird couple of 2 years. Okay, this isn't like the normal thing, Blake.
No, it's you know what. If that's a fever dream right here. The past All 2 years right. is a fever dream.
So Roger notices that the couple with the five kids who wants the free donuts and the free childcare for 2 hours isn't showing up. and Claire and the jolly gal gang, sans Marcelie.
I know.
Who, by the way, Marcelie and Fergus obviously are gone. They're a new burn.
Yes.
Malva Christie should be thanking her lucky stars that Marcelie is not here.
Oh, yes.
Because Malva got away with a smack that was half of a glove. Okay, Claire hit her like with a half gloved hand. So you know that smack didn't hurt too much.
No.
If Marcelie was there,
she would have pounded that girl into the center of the earth.
She would have taken out her spinning wheel and been all sorts of maleficent on her. Touch the spinning wheel.
She would have sent her to another friggin' dimension.
Oh my gosh.
And you know, like when you see
Marcelie
fight,
knows some witch stuff.
You know when you see a fight and someone's just on the person, just pounded away, and you're like, oh my God, stop. That's what Marcelie would have done to Malva.
She wouldn't have beat a pregnant woman.
She is pregnant, right?
Marcelie is no longer pregnant.
I forgot. Yeah, that's right. She had the kid.
She would have tattooed her face or something.
She would have done something. She drew like a big penis on her face.
She would have just written whore.
Just whore right on her forehead.
In a Sharpie.
is the show?
She would have taken one of Fergus's accessories, that's the Sharpie hand, and tattooed her face. Oh. Asked Ian how he got his tattoos.
Oh.
Knocked her out with some ether and just tattooed whore on her head. So, whore.
So this episode, and you're right, Mary, we get to the point where, you know, they go to the house and they see the people. And that was, like, kind of tragic because as a father, I'm looking at that and I see the father that he's, like, all kinds of messed up. And looking at the mother, she's all kinds of messed up. And you just get to the point where you can't do anything. Like, you just give up on trying to survive. And you watch your kids just fall apart. Like, I had a hard time with that.
That was a hard scene.
That was a hard scene because as a parent, you feel like you would give every last breath to making sure your kids live. And there just has to come a time where you're like,
can't even move.
I can't do it now.
You know, that scene was just so well directed because you felt tense. You were there when Mel was saying the baby won't drink. Yeah. And when, you know, they're trying to get the children up and Bree's running out for the water and Claire saying we need to have some light. It was so dark in there, obviously, but you were feeling it. And there was that moment when the mother died and the baby died and Claire's just standing there and I thought she was going to lose it for a second. Mm-hmm. You know, she just had that kind of stunned look that we've seen her had several times in this season. But you were there with them.
Yep,
in sure. Those tense moments.
Sure.
So we, of course, lose them. And it then kind of...
Well, the baby dies, and then the mother dies once the baby dies. Yeah.
And then we kind of cut, and we see several graves, you know, and there's lots of of deaths that have not happened due to dysentery.
That's good editing. Because, again, tell me a story without telling me a story.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what that is. Like, you showed me what happened, and then you cut to, oh, guess what? And it's much larger than what you
Oh,
think.
No, it didn't cut because we learned about what it was beforehand.
Oh, yeah, you're right. You're
we
right.
found the
no,
little
but either amoeba. Way, we still get like a little bit of information, and then we see the outcome, right?
Yes.
Still, good editing.
Yeah.
And I will admit, the only reason why I know what dysentery is because of Oregon Trail.
You and all of us, Blake. All of us listening right now.
That's it. That's the only
reason question,
why.
And the question, have we played Oregon Trail? Blake, have you?
Of course.
How do you see that state?
Oregon.
So if you're from it, you say Oregon.
Yeah, no, I don't care. No, that's they're friggin' banana.
Isn't that crazy?
It's Oregon.
That there's a game and the people from that state must be like, what the hell? There's a game named after our state. Well, the trail to, you know, to our state. Sure. And people can't even freaking get it right.
No.
No wonder everyone says it wrong.
If you're from Oregon, I'm sorry.
Oregon.
It's Oregon.
No. If it's someone's name...
No, there are people that say stupid, like, things weird all the time. Like, people say, instead of crayon, they say crayon.
No, I don't like it when people mispronounce the towns and cities from my own state. Here in Rhode Island, we have a lot of very difficult places to...
In Massachusetts, too.
Because of the American Indian names from the areas. What?
Even you couldn't pronounce some of the towns in Massachusetts.
Yeah, well, that was some... that, but that
Stoughton.
Wasn't...
Stoughton.
Oh. I was thinking dough, stow.
Stoughton. and Stoughton, by the way, not Stoughton.
Yeah, I know. I'm here, Blake. I get it.
For the listeners.
Okay, dysentery, Oregon Trail.
Oregon Trail.
Okay, dysentery.
Oregon Trail.
There's no cure.
No cure for dysentery.
You can get yourself some Gatorade.
All the Gatorade.
All the
electrolytes.
All the saltine crackers. You just hope and pray.
You know, you're hoping for a brat diet.
Some bananas.
Really?
Yeah. That's what I'm talking about.
You need a brat diet. When you
and you know what they don't have on the ridge?
What's
bananas.
That? No bananas.
No nanners.
They only have a rat diet.
Ew. Do they have rice? Probably not.
Probably not. So they have an at diet.
If they have applesauce left, how good is their canning skills?
And what's the tea?
Toast.
Why
wouldn't it just be bread? Why wouldn't it be the brab diet? Why does it have to be a brat diet?
I don't know.
Because toast makes me think you want butter on it, but you don't want dairy when you go on the brat diet.
No, you can't. You got.
And what the hell?
Toast.
What? Then just have bread. Who wants dry toast?
You know who wants dry toast? Tony Horton. For those of you who exercise P90X2, dry toast is tight.
Okay.
It's lean.
All right. Well, we're done with this conversation. Okay. So we see the amoeba. We see Malva liking the amoeba action. Mm-hmm. Awesome. We see all the dead people. the dead graves.
Yes.
And at this point, Bree goes, "Where's the Sin Eater? I haven't seen him in so long."
Yeah.
Okay.
That.
So do you understand what a Sin Eater is,
not
Blake?
All. Not
okay.
at all.
They do not explain this well.
Nope.
And they just they show you in the previously on Outlander the bread, and then the Sin Eater going to eat the bread, and them saying to Jemmy, "Oh, that's the Sin Eater's bread." Remember when the woman came back to life?
Yep. Yep.
And then we get Bree just mentioning it briefly here. So back like the fisher folk, crazy superstitious belief land, mm-hmm. and of the olden times. There was a person in your community paid to eat the sins of your life.
Huh.
And they would eat the offering of bread. And in that sense, they would be eating your sins. So then you can go and have your sins taken away as you pass.
Hmm.
And the Sin Eater was usually someone who was kind of shunned anyway from society. And they would actually get paid to eat your sins. And that's kind of how they had their livelihood, is they would just come and they'd eat the bread from all these dead people. So that's why Bree's saying it, because now they've had all these funerals and the Sin Eater isn't showing up to do his one job.
Where are you, bro?
You're supposed to show up when all the people die.
You only get 2 weeks paid vacation.
But this was a thing that they would do. And the person was ostracized from society anyway, because nobody wants to be, because the person is supposedly full of everybody's sins.
Oh, okay. All right. Makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
so that's why he's not like in the regular part of society. He's yep. not like hanging out with the Christies
gotcha.
And, you know, helping Bree by the river yep. because he's shunned by society. But that's his J-O-B.
Gotcha.
And he's not showing up to do his J-O-B when right. dysentery is taken over the ridge.
All right. Well, you mentioned Bree, and we mentioned how this episode feels like two different or even three different episodes. We're going to talk about that. But first, we're going to talk and thank our partners. So, you know, you want to sound good. You want to look good. You want to be the best you can be, especially with the Burns dinner coming up soon.
The Burns supper.
The Burns supper, dinner, whatevs. Stats for nerds. The place you want to go for the Burns supper, if you're going, you want to look good, you got to go get in touch with scotlandshop.com. You go there, they hook you up with all the great tartans, and you can have your own virtual appointments. You can talk to somebody who actually knows what they're talking about when it comes to the tartans and the history and what you should wear. And they can hook you up with all the different accessories and everything, the stuff that I definitely need because I'm a jabroni when it comes to this stuff. Go to scotlandshop.com because they have all the best stuff right there for you.
Love it. I love scotlandshop.com. Plus, we have
nice.
A code. We have a coupon.
We have a coupon code for you. Well, I like to say discount code.
Yeah, me too.
The discount code. Use the discount code.
And you don't just need to get kilts. Like, that's the thing.
Right. You get all the accessories,
There's
too.
All the accessories. It's a little, like, blanky shawl.
If, like, you don't know what to get your husband for, like, his birthday or you know, Valentine's or Father's Day or whatever. I don't know. With Father's Day is coming up soon. Or if you don't know what to get your wife because Mother's Day is coming up, whatever. Get them something from scotlandshop.com. Because if your wife loves Scotland and Outlander, dude, that's a built-in gift.
You know what? If you're a mother, I'm just going to tell you what I do. Shop for yourself. Okay? Just shop for yourself.
Just treat yourself.
No, what do we call it, Blake? What do we call the Sunday after Mother's Day in this house?
What?
Makeup Mother's Day. No,
that's true.
And I do what I actually want.
That's true. Good point. So do what you want, treat yourself, and go to scotlandshop.com, and you can get a 15% discount thanks to our discount code, Outlander. So scotlandshop.com, discount code, 15% off, Outlander. All right, Marvin, so we talked about Bree, and I want to bring up Bree because there's actually something that happens here that is not on the nose.
She tells Claire she's pregnant?
No. Although she did tell Claire that she was pregnant in this really weird time.
Well, like, she probably thought her mom was going to die, and
yeah.
it's like the first time she sees her son's dying fear.
They were talking really close, too, by the way. Could you imagine the morning breath from Claire? The dragon breath that must be coming out of her?
Blake, they didn't have deodorant back then. People probably farted a lot. Stinky just, pits. So Claire just sweat for a week straight. Who knows what her bedpan situation was like?
Oh, good point.
Okay, her dragon breath, least of their worries.
So, irrespective of Claire's dragon breath, and irrespective of Bree's choice to tell her when she's pregnant,
I think it was a good choice.
Bree, there's a great conversation between Bree and Roger. By the way, Roger showing up to protect Jamie the way that he did, like in terms of like defending him in front of Bree, huge for Roger Mack. Still not going to say that
hey,
he's
stop. We don't call him names.
I'm still not going to say that he's my hero, like I did last episode because I was coaxed into doing so. I was bamboozled.
Hero, baby.
I was bamboozled.
Just move on.
The fact of the matter is this. The fact of the matter is this. Bree is doubting Jamie a little bit. And Roger defends him. But what I love is that the show is telling you that Bree is messed up a little bit because of the trauma she's had from her parents. Like her daddy and her mom. Not Jamie and her mom, but Frank and her mom. Because she watched
a loveless marriage,
someone in Frank who was probably stepping out, and she's traumatized from that. She has been conditioned to not have full faith in a partner, which probably informs her actions with Roger in many ways.
And let's not forget, her mom was still technically kind of married to Frank while she was banging and married to Jamie.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. Bree needs all the copays. All the copays when it comes to having a clear foundation on loyalty to your partner. And it's not to say shame on Claire or shame on Frank. But yes, Blake, her upbringing, it's got a lot of holes. It's like Swiss cheese when it comes to
yes.
solid foundations of staying true to your partner. And I don't think that it's wrong for her to have these conversations with her husband. I don't think it's wrong for her to say,
oh, no,
my parents aren't superheroes.
Yes.
You know, everybody makes mistakes. Even my daddy, who I thought was the best man on this planet,
mm-hmm.
made this kind of a mistake. So this sucks. That this is now being brought up. Thanks a lot, Mrs. Bug.
Yes. Yeah, Mrs. Bug. Lady
Whistledown. Little Whistledown.
Lady Whistlebug. I wanted to point that conversation out, and I wanted to point that emotional tone out, because I felt like that was a really special part of the episode that I think is undervalued, because it actually gives you some texture for Bree. Because so far for me, Bree has been nothing more than just, I'm Jamie's daughter. Like, she just doesn't have, like, can you explain Bree to me as a character?
Through the show's lens, not too awfully well.
Exactly.
Yet.
Exactly.
Yet.
All I'm saying is this is one of the first things that the show has done to actually give her something.
I would say that her trying to build the plumbing and the water wheel is another thing as well in her matches. So we're getting a lot of insight in the doing of what what Bree wants to do. And we get her as a mother, and we have to remember that she's gone through her own trauma, and she's come back in time to warn her parents. So there is a lot to Bree, a lot to her, but compared to other characters, I agree.
Yeah, and again, this is it's not a Mary and Blake commandment.
She's just not as dynamic
it's
to watch.
Tenet of Mary and Blake. If you can explain a character to me without telling me their name, what they look like, or what job they do, then you have a good character.
And I think you can do that with Bree. It's just she's not as fleshed out as some other characters right now, and that's okay.
Yep.
Just
no,
have
it's
some
okay.
patience.
I'm saying is, this is a good thing.
Yes.
Because it's the first, it's one of the first things that the show has done to give us something other than her name, what she looks like, or what she does.
But we can, but we've talked about too how this next generation is getting more fleshed out in this season. How each of these characters is really having some moments to shine. You know, we got Ferguson, Marcelly, and Ian, and Roger. We've said this now almost every single episode about the younger generation. Like, oh, mm-hmm. this was a really nice layer to them. So I don't think it's not on purpose.
All right, so let's acknowledge the elephant in the room here. The Malva of it all.
Let's do it. Now I'm just going to sit back and say lots of interestings. Oh, Claire's hair, first off. Malva was in on that.
Yeah, and
Malva again, and Mrs. Bug.
And again, this is like what they where do with the that show hair. Feels like three separate shows. The first one is the death part of the show. The second one is like Claire getting sick. And then the third one is the murder mystery and the plot,
the pregnancy and the pregnancy sex. Plot turn.
Like, it's three shows combined into one. So Toni, like I said, like we said at the top of our episode here, Toni Graphia had
a doozy,
a monumental task to actually make this work and give it a through line. And you can tell that she struggled with it. Because they had to do these time jumps at the end of the episode to give us, like, a working plot.
I wouldn't say a working plot, but they just had to have pretty significant time jumps.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, in order to get from A to Z, they couldn't...
Lots of movies and shows have to do that.
I know. But because there's so much and because it's the subject matters... are like adjacent to each other, where they're not directly tied to one another, although they are, but like...
But for example, when Claire was sick, in the books, it's supposed to be she could be dying. And we're in the books, and I know, show is show, book is books, but this is why I'm saying it felt like it could have been multiple episodes. I don't think we got to have the severity of how scared her family was that she actually might be dying, how scared Jamie was that she actually might be dying through this. So I don't, yes, she was out for a week, and oh my gosh, she was so sick, and you know, Jamie talks about how skinny she is, so we understand that it took a massive toll on
but
her.
But I never got the sense that she was going to die.
Exactly.
Like, just like how I never got the sense that Tom Christie is supposed to be falling in love with Claire.
I think...
I kind of get a sniff of it, but I don't...
I think admiration is a better
it's
word.
It's not like I'm waking up to bacon in the morning.
Yeah, but would you say he admires her?
I think he's like a 10-year-old with her. Like, he likes her and he hates her at the same time.
That's okay.
But that's what I'm getting.
I think that's okay. I think that Tom Christie is conflicted. So it's okay for you to kind of get that gist from the show so far. And I'm not saying their fast-forwarding was a bad choice. They had to do what they had to do because of such a short season and because of the difficulties that they've had over filming for this season just because of the panorama.
And I'm not putting Toni down. I'm actually trying to say that. Like, I'm trying to commend her, be like, this is a monumental task, and I get why some people didn't like this episode, because it's just too much.
I enjoyed it. You know who I think did an amazing job was Katrina Balf in this episode.
Because she had a lot
of range. Yes, her range of acting. For all you think, the long hair and saving people and the short hair and the fear and the... C-section, I mean, and the emotional struggle that she had to go through in the stables, having that conversation with Jamie, like, all of her scenes were very, very believable, even though they were such big things, and even though it was such a fast-paced episode with the things that were happening, Claire Fraser was very believable the entire time for me.
Sure, and she has that terrible dream about Malva, like, coming in and, like, telling her... like, your husband loves me because you're old and the veins are sticking out in your hands and everything. And she has that dream and she's still haunted by Lionel Brown, which is obviously important.
Yeah.
But you said that Katrina Balfe did a great job. She did, and she especially did a great job. I believed her when she said, "You come near me or my husband again, and I will effing kill you."
Yep.
Like, that is some bad news.
Clear, don't mess.
Bad news energy right there.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if words could kill, Malva is literally dead. I mean, and then she does die. But,
goodbye.
I loved that moment there because it was a very modern moment in a show that is, you know, a past set show.
Mm-hmm. It felt very Frank to me.
What do you mean?
Like, that's something Frank Randall would have done.
You think so?
Frank Randall would have taken that Malva, taken that little surgical knife.
Really?
Back alley Frank?
Oh, back alley Frank. Okay. Yeah, you're right. All right. I gotcha.
That's what I'm talking about. Yep, yep. That's what that reminded me of.
Back alley Frank.
Like, you're going to mess with my family? Because that's, of course, when they were saying, we found Claire, meet us in the back alley. And then, of course, it was a lie. And that's what it reminded me of. You're going to mess with my partner? I will kill you.
Have we gotten enough of the Christies to appreciate the fact that they as a unit are messed up, not just Malva? Like, is the show putting too much pressure on the character of Malva to be the heel, you know, to be the big bad, if you will?
I think just kind of the fisher folk in general, or the superstition that they all have. And then we even get, you know, Alan coming out saying she's a witch and we know what happens to witches. I think the pressure that this society has, and it's just kind of personified in the Christies, is what I get out of it. You know, Claire's there for 2 months saying she's ostracized from the society. Mm-hmm. Nobody's talking to her. So we know that these people, Malva even talks about somebody who wouldn't come see Claire because he thinks she's a witch. Mm-hmm. So the way that I'm taking it is, yeah, the Christies are weird and they've got these weird beliefs, but it's not just the Christies. It's this whole society that's living on the ridge now, that has these bad beliefs about Claire, that has these beliefs that she's a witch, that sides with the Christies. And so you're going to add that element now into what just happened at the end of this episode.
Yes. And here's another question I have for you. And I know you know the answer, so I'm not asking you for the answer. What I'm asking you for is what the show is telling you.
How about you, Blake? What is the show telling you?
Well, hold on. Let me just ask the question.
Okay.
Do you think the show is telling you that Malva is taking pleasure in accusing Jamie? Like, the way it... Like, you know how she was, like, kind of getting off on cutting the sin eater's fingers? I almost got a hint of that when she is accusing Jamie of being the baby daddy, like going full Maury Povich. You are the father.
In your crescent shape and the scars on your
back. Yeah, I almost got a hint of that. Or is the show telling you that she is being, not being forced, but she is doing something that she knows she shouldn't be doing? What do you think the show is telling you?
I don't know.
Well, I know you know the answer, so I know that's a hard...
I'm
putting you in a hard position.
Interesting. What do you think? You answer this question, Blake.
I think the show is kind of telling me both.
I would concur.
And I don't think it's because of the scene that it's telling me that. I think the show is indicating that through her actions in previous episodes. She is full poison ivy at this point, in my opinion.
Okay.
But there's also something that's happening there that I don't think she was prepared for. Because there is that moment with Claire when she's like
when Claire goes to visit her.
Yeah, and it's like right on the tip of her tongue. It's like right there. And then she stops. So maybe it's like she started down a path and then the flame got a little too hot, but something bad happened. Like, she was clearly and is clearly gunning for Jamie. But I think she got too close to the sun. She's Icarus. She got too close to the sun, and her wax wings melted.
Look at you quoting Hamilton again. Speaking of Hamilton,
yes.
Here's our fun little bit for the time traveler question for you, Blake.
Okay, what do you got?
Doc, you better back up. We don't have enough road to get up to 88.
Roads? Where we're going, we don't need roads.
If you knew about the Continental Congress, would you be trying out for it?
This kind of relates to the last week's question.
Like, Jamie... Okay, fine. I'll do a different one then. Ready? Is it cheating if your wife isn't actually alive in that time period? Did Jamie cheat on Claire with Mary McNabb?
Okay. Did he? No, he didn't cheat on her. Because he didn't know that Claire was going to be coming back. Like, he didn't know any of that. Like, you can't blame the guy for trying to move on with his life.
I mean, he wasn't trying to move on with his life. He was just trying to feel good. And so is Mary McNabb.
Yeah, well, he's trying to feel human.
Yeah. Exactly.
Like, that's what I'm saying. Like, he's trying to feel human, so he's trying to move on. He's trying to, like, be more than what he was, which is like a feral dog, you know, like, at that time. So, no, I don't think it's cheating. I don't... And, like, that whole confession with the Mary McNabb thing, while funny, like, who the hell's Mary McNabb? It felt forced and awkward a little bit to me. But either way, no, I don't think it's cheating. Do you think it's cheating?
I don't. I totally don't. I'm like, Jamie, come on. Either you tell, like, the way he was saying it and Claire's look, it was like he was going to say, I did sleep with Malva. You know, he had this suspense kind of thing. Well, you know, I do have something to tell you. After she just did this whole thing, I'm not supposed to be here, and neither is Bree nor Roger nor Jemmy. Oh, well, I do have something to admit. Freaking Mary McNabb. Come on, Jamie. Yeah, fine. But, like, is now the right time? I guess, fine. It just, he scared Claire for a second there, and I think that it was unnecessary.
Yeah, that it felt very writerly. I will say that. That whole back and forth.
But I enjoyed that. That was great.
I loved the confrontation. Like, I loved the fact that Claire did call out the fact, like, I loved you more than I should have. And all of us are here because of that, and none of us should be here, but we are. I loved the fact that the show did that. But when Jamie does the whole, well, I gotta confess, and, like, Claire's like, wait,
there's
what?
That moment of...
It's like, it's very writerly.
And well, I felt like it was to kind of psych the show watchers out.
Yes. Yes.
Because as a book reader, you read that. I don't even remember which book right now. Oh, my God. But you read it when it happened. You like Jamie goes over all of these, like, cave memories and everything. And that's when that all happens. So it's just interesting.
Yeah.
Okay, Mal.
I will say that the thing with Jamie, it was. I don't think it was very writerly. Like I said, I feel like it was there for the sake of being there, and I also kind of feel like the twist with Malva and the pregnancy and blaming it on Jamie, that is not, I think, as twisty as the show thinks it is.
Well, it's interesting because she asks him about Lord Lovett. Oh, wasn't your grandsire Lord Lovett? Like, what does have to do with anything?
Yeah, that's very smart. That's a very smart catch, because I didn't even think about that.
Yeah. Why do you think she asks him about that?
I don't know. I'm not sure. Maybe because she knows what she's getting into, and, like, she thinks that she's going to be taken care of. Like, I don't know. I'm not sure.
Okay, so Claire goes in the garden. Oh,
yeah, Claire goes in the garden, and I will say that it is more of a twist than her being pregnant, which is now she's croaked, Malva.
Yeah,
she is straight up croaked.
And then Claire does a C-section, which doesn't exist at that time.
Nope. Nope.
So that's going to look great.
Yeah, that's not great, Bob. And the show, I think, was setting up Malva to be the big bad for the sake of the show watcher. But now we get to this point where we realize...
She ain't it.
It's Mm-mm. something else.
Mm-hmm.
And that something else is probably what is provoking her into lying about Jamie.
So, Blake, give us this Chernobyl hot take of an outlandish theory.
Oh, you want the outlandish theory now?
Oh, and Ian, poor Ian, being like, I had sex. Might be my baby.
You're like, Ian, no, it's not.
And then Claire's to be like, well, she was sleeping with everybody.
Yeah, so why don't we just...
Sorry, Ian.
Let's pump the brakes.
But I'll do it. I'll take it for Uncle Jamie. Plus, she's hot.
I know. Ian just willing to take the L for Uncle Jamie. Like,
I love it.
That is great stuff. All right. Let's get to the outlandish theory of the week, shall we?
Please.
I want to let you know that this outlandish theory of the week is brought to you by WeBox.
Oh, listen, I love WeBox.
Can't get enough WeBox. And here's the deal, ladies and gents. This WeBox that's currently going on right now takes you back. Takes you back to where it all began. Back in Scotland, 5 carefully curated gifts, and they're all exclusive to WeBox, and they celebrate
Outlander
all themed. Outlander.
Oh,
my goodness.
Be still my heart.
And the one that I want to call out right now,
yeah,
it's celebrating the union between Jamie and Claire. They're beautiful, just stunning, gorgeous, excellent, fantastic, just beaming with love. It's the recreation of Claire's wedding ring. And it's silver plated, and it's fully adjustable, so
yes,
you can enjoy.
So you can adjust it.
Wearing in your own comfort, and feeling a unique connection to the Outlander legend. It's in that's just one of the carefully curated WeBox gifts, and that
it
is your
Scotland.
Gateway to romance, mystery, and the heritage of Scotland.
Love it.
It just. Get out of here with how great that is.
Okay, so if people are like, all right, I'm gonna try me out this WeBox.
Yep.
What do they need to do?
You got to go to webox.co.uk. We've been saying .com. That I don't want you to go there. I want you to go to webox.co.uk.
Okay.
All right? If you go there, you can even get a 10% discount by using the discount code. Again, we're here. We're taking care of you. We are taking care of you.
These are a few of our favorite things.
By giving you this discount code, 10% off, use the discount code Outlander. All right? All right. Here's my... I got a couple. I'm going to save the Chernobyl one.
I'm going to get super cozy.
This is a microwave take. All right. I'm not full on Chernobyl yet. Okay,
you don't even reheat it on the stove. You microwave it. Get soggy.
It's no coincidence that Lionel Brown's brother. What's his name? Matt. Tom.
What?
Yeah, the Brown.
The Brown. The Brownsvilles.
Yeah. The other Jabrownie. I can't remember his name now. What?
Just crack me up.
It's no coincidence that that guy is leading up the safety committee. What?
No, you just crack me up.
He's on the safety committee, right? It's no coincidence that he's got a beef with Jamie and Claire. And it's no coincidence Claire is going to be found in the middle of the garden with a fully croaked Malva.
And baby.
And a dead baby in her hands. Like... 0.0 coincidence that this is all happening, because he is going to hear about this Malva being croaked and he's going to arrest either Jamie or Claire, and it's going to be bad. It's going to be bad news for what's coming up. I'm thinking that everyone's going to blame Jamie for it, but since Claire is literally caught blood on her hands, people might blame Claire.
And they think she's a witch.
And they think that she's a witch. Fair enough.
That's not great.
So yeah, that's my take. The Browns are coming back for the phrases, and this is how they're going to get their revenge for Lionel being killed.
Interesting.
So I like that. But here's my Chernobyl take.
Okay.
Right. This is like radiation, like 12 million Ronkin, okay, level radiation, all right? The show did this really interesting thing. And this is a great filming.
Interesting use of interesting.
And this is, it's a great editing technique. You'll see that, like, in episodes of television or movies, something will be like, somebody will say, who could have done this? Or who is responsible for this? Or something like that. And the next smash cut is the person that is responsible for the thing that they're asking, right? It's an editing technique to tell you, again, the story without actually telling you, this is it. And the same exact thing happens here in the conversation between Claire and Malva. Malva is just about to tell Claire the truth about whatever. Claire's like, listen, I can help you. You got to tell me the truth. It's okay. And she's just about to do it. And then Claire's like, what is going on? And in the background, just as Malva is about to spout the information, who do you see in the background and the focus shifts to automatically?
I don't know.
It's Alan. Here's the deal. This is a filmmaking technique that is widely used, and if you pay attention to how things are filmed, you get the answer right away, and that is this. Something happened to Malva, and there's a reason why she is lying, right? There's a reason why both Tom Christie and Claire got sick and had the same sickness that was different from anybody else. You got to think, who gains the most from both of those two people being croaked if they do die? It's Malva. Because Malva knows that she's pregnant, number one, and if her dad dies, she don't get to deal with him. And number two, she knows that if Claire dies, then she can swoop in and live with Jamie because she can lie that it's his kid, and then she's taken care of because she's gone full poison ivy. And she's using the fingers that she's been cutting off, not just for the love charms. I think she's using the fingers to get them sick.
Ew.
Somehow, some way.
Finger juice.
And or here's the other thing. Note too that Jamie's like, oh, this tea. Like, oh, Claire gave me this tea when I had the venom from the snake that bit me. Mm-hmm. Malva is making this tea to protect Jamie because Malva's done something to the water or she's done something to the food that Jamie and Claire and everybody else is drinking.
Ew.
So she's given Jamie the antidote, and she's not giving it to Claire. And she's getting both of them sick because she knows she's going to lie. And why is she lying?
Why, Blake?
Because Alan has something to do with this. Either, here's the Chernobyl. Well, here's one thing. Either he's in on it. He knows who the problem is.
Who what problem is?
Like, and he knows who did this to her. And he is making her lie about Jamie. Or here's the Chernobyl take.
Okay.
Chernobyl take.
Bum, bum, bum.
Like, the world is sizzling right now. He's the father. Because that family messed up to the gills. You can't get any more messed up than the Christies. And you can't tell me that there's no, like, flowers in the attic going on.
Ew. I'm
telling you.
Ew.
That family's weird. And this is why I'm saying the show has put too much pressure on Malva to be the big bad, because it's going to turn around and be like, no, it wasn't Malva. It's been Alan the whole time. You know, that guy that got his ass kicked by his dad and Jamie the entire time? He's the real bad guy. I find it hard to believe. And I don't believe that he's the bad guy. But I do believe that either he's in on it or there's some flowers in the attic happening.
Oh, gross.
Just telling you, that's how I feel. Mark it zero.
Also, if she's sleeping around with all these people, how do we even know who could the father be? Like yeah, Claire said.
The way that they edited it, they made it, it's a clear indication that Alan is a part of this. Because as soon as he comes up, Malva's whole attitude turns on a dime. And not only does it turn, she doubles down.
Mm-hmm.
And she goes even further. And that's when we get the whole problem happening, right? So Alan is either in on it or he did it. And why is he in on it? And again, think of who has the most to gain. If Tom Christie dies, that means Alan doesn't have to deal with his dad anymore. And then if Claire dies, Malva can swoop in and be with Jamie, and Alan is in on the main crew here. He's got all the things. I'm just telling you, Alan is either in on it or he did it. And they're trying to cover it up.
Interesting.
So that's all I'm going to say. Mark at zero, dude.
Interesting.
Mark me.
Who do you think killed Malva? Hang up and try again.
Oh, that's a good question. And Claire, obviously.
I mean, how do you know? She was ether crazy.
Yeah, but if she was ether crazy, that means that she's knocked out. Like, we've seen what ether does to her, and that it puts her on Mars.
She's been seeing things.
Yeah, but if she's on Mars, she ain't walking around killing people. Like, she's just in bed.
Okay.
So it ain't Claire. It ain't Roger. It ain't Bree.
How do you know? They wouldn't do it, would they?
Wouldn't do it. I think a dark horse is Ian. Because he's trying to protect Uncle Jamie. And he probably found out that Malva was sleeping with other people. And he's like, screw you, lady.
I give you my sex bracelet.
If I can't have you, nobody can. I have a really messed up relationship with sex. The other one, I don't think it's Tom.
Could it be Jamie?
Could be Jamie, but I don't see him slitting little girls' throats.
Could it be a different fisher folk person?
No, because they got nothing to gain. You know what it could be? Could be Alan. Because if they're going to make Alan the father of the baby or him in on it, then what's to say that he can't go the next step further? Like, what's to say that he doesn't go crazy and just kill Malva? Like what is to say that he can't do that?
You are going down some really crazy routes right now.
I'm just thinking about it, and I'm like, well, it could be him. Because maybe like him lying about...
Sadly, we know it can't be Marcelli, because you know she'd be down with that.
If Marcelli was around, I would have said 100% Garen-frackin-teed.
Yep.
That it would have been her.
She would have said, Fergus, put on your knife attachment. We're going to the garden.
Like, she absolutely would have done it. So, I don't know.
That's why she has to be a new burn. Everyone's like, why are they gone?
Because
she can't be a suspect.
Yeah, nope.
She'd be Miss Scarlet.
And then there's not enough other characters for it to be impactful. Like, it ain't Kezzy or Desi or Josie or whoever.
Or Lizzie.
It ain't Lizzie. Lizzie can't even tell her ass from her elbow. So,
what do you mean? What are you, just because she has malaria?
She's got malaria. She's
how about Mrs. Bug?
Around. Mrs. Bug.
Ooh, oh, dark
Mrs.
horse.
Mrs. Bug would do it just so she could write some Whistlebug papers.
Hmm.
That's a super dark horse. Like, there's a dark horse in Ian. I'm willing to have a conversation about that. But the super dark horse,
Mrs. Bug.
But more than likely, it's Alan.
You know who it's not?
Who?
The Sin Eater.
Definitely not the Sin Eater.
That would be awesome. Left.
He couldn't hold on to the knife.
Clay can't bring him back to life.
All right, you ready to close this bad boy out?
I am. I'm falling asleep,
Blake.
Yeah,
we're getting a delirium.
You're talking
now. It's 10:45.
Too long. Oh my God, I'm so tired.
All right, let's do it. Let's close it out.
If there's any doubt how much we love you all and how much we love Outlander, know this. We're podcasting from bed.
With a mini studio.
Talking about Malva and Mrs. Bug Whistle Down. Whistlebug.
Whistlebug.
Hey, how excited is Claire to go to Philadelphia? I'm going to go to the next one.
Oh, yeah, she's in. And Roger's such a little history dork. He's like, dude, I can't wait to go. Jamie, hurry up, please.
Jamie's like, sorry, I have to go get rid of Malva for a hot second, then I'll come.
Oh, man. Here's the problem. I know I would be Roger in that situation. I know that I'd be like, dude, we gotta go.
Why is that a problem?
We gotta do this. Like, we totally would have done that.
Why is that a problem?
Because I hate knowing the fact that I'm somehow related to Roger in any way.
God, stop hating on him, Blake.
It's become a thing. That's a matter of principle.
It's
now.
Not. It's because you are Roger. You're not Jamie.
No, I'm definitely not Jamie.
I am Jamie.
Not at all.
I'm not a doctor.
No, you are not Claire.
No.
By any stretch.
100% not Claire. Who would I be on the ridge?
Marcelly.
I would be Marcelly.
Yeah, you'd be Marcelly. All right, everybody. Thank you so much for taking the time to listen to Outlander Cast and us in bed making all these stupid, silly jokes and having a good time.
For the nipples during labor alone.
I know, right? And remember that
no,
we...
that's all I get.
I appreciate it. It's good.
Well, no, not during labor. To start labor.
Remember, we do have a goal to get to 900 patrons. So we are hoping to get...
We're inching our way.
We are inching our way. We're at like 860 right now. And remember also that if we do get to 900, you at jointhenerdclan.com will be able to choose whatever reward you so desire.
It pretty much has to be a Blake reward, though, okay?
No, it could be a Blake, one-off reward.
I know. I'm just saying. I'm tired, okay? Make Blake do some stuff.
I do a lot. I'm just saying... It could be a movie commentary, and we've had some other ideas and other shows that people have been thinking of. We could do another Minute with Mary that is an experiment on me, if you will. We've done that before. It's probably going to be like a one-off reward.
You can have Blake bake cinnamon rolls and share his recipe.
That's right. We've talked about baking cinnamon rolls and me doing a video of how I bake my famous cinnamon rolls or my world-famous cookies.
Your cookies are better than your cinnamon rolls.
They are.
You haven't perfected the cinnamon rolls.
I haven't gotten the cinnamon rolls 100% yet. I agree. I'm like 85% there.
The caramelization is not quite good.
I know. You know, I actually talked to our resident baker, Tammy, about that.
Good.
She's helping me out with the cinnamon filling.
Good.
Which is really good. Or on my pizza recipe.
The pizza is very good.
So we've talked about doing those things, those tutorials. But know that it will be a one-off.
It's not another podcast.
Not another podcast.
I'm tired.
And Mary's so tired. So if we get 900 members, we will do that. So please go to jointhenerdclan.com.
We meaning Blake.
And become a member there. Also, please too, go to the Mary and Blake socials where you will be able to vote for Mary and I in the Best of Rhode Island award.
Going.
What are you saying?
I'm tired. You just keep talking.
Well,
okay,
here,
I'll put the microphone down. Everyone, you know it's me, Mary. Blake's going to keep talking.
So do know that you can go to maryandblake.com or you can check out our socials and vote for us in the Best of Rhode Island Awards for the Best Podcast of Rhode Island. All you have to do is just write in Mary and Blake Media in the Best Podcast of Rhode Island section for the statewide awards. Yes. So do that, and that's that. So thank you so much once again. I appreciate it. Look forward to the listener feedback episode coming up probably this weekend as I'm going to Florida. Or maybe we'll do it next week. Yeah, sure. Whatevs. I don't know. We'll see. We'll make some bad decisions. We'll have some fun with it. As for now, though, ladies and gents, my name is Blake. That's Mary, and you've been listening to Outlander Cast.